Good morning. We start with a major development in the Baltimore bridge collapse in the United States. The desperate search has now been suspended for six workers missing since a cargo ship lost power and slammed into a pylon, bringing the bridge down. We'll go straight to our US correspondent, Jonathan Kersley, who's in Baltimore for us. Jonathan, tell us what the latest is, what you're hearing.
Davina, it is a very sad development from here in Baltimore tonight. It's 19 hours since the Francis Scott Key Bridge crumbled behind me, sending people and cars plummeting metres into the chilly waters of the Patapsco River. The bridge was struck by the cargo ship, the Dali, and within seconds of that impact, the bridge simply crumpled. After hours and hours of searching from the air, on the water and beneath the water using divers, the US Coast Guard has now confirmed that this is no longer an active search and rescue mission. Instead, they are into the recovery phase. Authorities here tonight now believe that the six people who were unaccounted for much of today, six construction workers who were working on that bridge to fix potholes on the four-lane, 2.5-kilometre stretch of road across the Patapsco River, are alive. This is an incredibly sad development for a community that had been clinging on to hope, and now there are serious questions that will need to be answered in the investigation that will be carried out by the National Transport Safety Bureau. The US Coast Guard spoke just a short time ago, and this is some of what they had to say.
At this point, we do not believe that we're going to find any of these individuals still alive. And so this evening at about 7:30, we are going to suspend the active search and rescue efforts.
The last thing we want to do is put divers in the water with changing currents, low temperatures, very poor visibility, and so much metal and other unknown objects in the water. All it takes is one object to strike an individual, and all of a sudden we have a first responder trying to recover another first responder.
Davina, as you can see, darkness has now fallen here. The ship behind me is just a silhouette of what it was, and the bridge, or at least the crumpled steel metal from it, is very much sticking up out of the water. This is going to be a major cleanup operation. This is a hugely busy port. It is a hugely busy harbour and vital for this city's economy. The collapse of the bridge has actually shut this harbour. It means that goods can't get in and they can't get out. There's some 30 ships that are actually stuck inside, and this is going to take a significant amount of time, days, weeks, perhaps even months, in order to get this all cleaned up and get this port back up and running. Tonight, there have also been vigils held at a Baptist church, a chance for this community to join in prayer, sparing a thought for the families of those six unaccounted for victims who authorities now believe are no longer alive. Davina.
The NFL has been rocked by bombshell allegations of a secret drug testing program, allowing players to avoid detection and heavy penalties, allegedly with the league's approval. Nine's chief football reporter Tom Morris is at AFL House in Melbourne. Tom, good morning to you. You've been following developments and a lot has happened in the last few hours. What's the latest on these claims?
Well, the latest is that Andrew Dillon, the AFL CEO, will speak in about 27 minutes here at the AFL in response to these claims. Now, the AFL, their belief and their strong belief is that everything that's been reported falls under the AFL illicit drugs policy, which is a policy that focuses on medication and protection and also player welfare. So players regularly self-report to doctors, and the doctors is then incumbent on these medical professionals within the clubs to make sure that those players don't play on game day if there are drugs in their system, because if they did, that would be considered performance enhancing. So there's a lot to unpack here, but this all began last night when MP Andrew Wilkie put this on the table in Parliament, and he was questioned today as well on these issues.
I'm sure you would understand I can't add anything at this point in time.
So the AFL has just the AFL's just released a statement just then, and as part of it, it says it is absolutely imperative that no doctor or club official should ever allow or encourage a player to take the field knowing they have recently taken an illicit substance. So in other words, what the AFL is saying is it is incumbent on the doctors to make sure that players don't play on the weekend if, of course, there's drugs in their system. So my understanding is, and I've spoken to a couple of different club officials today, including medical professionals, this is very normal practice at Clubland. The next question is, should this be a normal practice at Clubland? And that's one of the things the AFL is reviewing at the moment with its illicit drugs policy. Simon Goodwin this morning spoke at Casey. Of course, Melbourne is front and centre. And he said he has never been aware of any player missing a game due to drugs and masquerading as a hamstring or any other issue.
Well, it's news to me. So I think it's a surprise to everyone in the industry because there's no line of sight for me as my position as a head coach. I haven't got a line of sight on what that policy looks like. So I understand the policy, but I don't get the information that people would expect to get. So, yeah, it's news to me.
So the crux of the issue is this. The AFL has a policy which is arguably flawed. In the eyes of many, it's flawed. In the eyes of Glenn Bartlett and the former Melbourne doctor, it's flawed. It's gone to Parliament, which has allowed for parliamentary privilege for this doctor to speak about it. But the absolute nub of it is, should players miss games because they've tested positive to drugs during the week? And if that is the case, should more people than just the doctor be aware of it? Should the public be aware of it? There's so much to play out here. It hasn't come as a huge shock to people in the industry, but the way that it's played out today certainly makes me think that the AFL might even expedite or accelerate their illicit drugs policy review, which they've been undertaking now for several months.
OK, so they'll be speaking in about 26 minutes' time, Tom. We'll see what they have to say. Thank you so much for the breaking news. Well, the National Disability Insurance Scheme is in for a major overhaul, with the federal government vowing to crack down on scammers and fraudsters and ensure money goes to people most in need. Government Services Minister Bill Shorten introduced the bill to Parliament this morning.
Ignoring price gouging and unethical conduct is a betrayal of NDIS participants and Aussie taxpayers and jeopardises the credibility and the social licence of the scheme. Further legal changes are coming to more strongly prohibit and punish such unethical practices.
He says the changes are about making the scheme more financially sustainable. There's more breaking news out of Canberra right now, where Labor's rushed new immigration legislation won't be introduced before a pivotal High Court case in April. The Coalition is refusing to support that legislation in the Senate today. We'll go live to our federal politics reporter, Claudia Vajoljak. Claudia, good morning to you. It has been quite a morning in the Nationals' capital. Bring us up to speed.
It has been, Davina, and I can confirm that in the last few minutes, this has been referred to a committee, so it will not pass today. The opposition slamming the process, labelling it as shambolic. It did not back the bill today, instead making a move to refer it to a Senate inquiry to be scrutinised further. Labor introduced the tough new laws yesterday, which include jail time for immigration detainees who refuse to cooperate with efforts to have them deported, also banning nationals from applying for Australian visas in countries that refuse to take them back. The government tried to rush the legislation through within 48 hours before next month's crucial High Court decision on the outcome of an Iranian man who is refusing to cooperate with deportation efforts. But the Coalition says Labor hasn't explained the need for urgency, claiming there hasn't been enough time to do proper checks and balances.
It's very difficult for the Coalition to support such a rushed passage of this legislation. We are very concerned about unintended consequences. We are very concerned about the failure to do work on third country resettlement options. We are very concerned that this might inadvertently encourage people to get back on boats again.
Both the Immigration and Home Affairs Ministers have been criticised for refusing to address media over these significant legislative changes. Claire O'Neill this morning dodged our questions, leaving it to the Climate Change and Energy Minister to defend the need for the laws.
Do you expect legal challenges to come out of this legislation if it's passed?
I'm so sorry, I've got to go to a meeting.
This is major legislation. This is major legislation and you're not taking questions on it.
What's your response?
I think it's appropriate the government has a bit more of a toolkit to deal with those people.
You had a minister running away from the media today, refusing to answer questions about this legislation. And you've got another minister, the Minister for Immigration, who's in witness protection and will not answer any questions from the media. What are they hiding?
Today's developments mean the government's new powers won't be in place before the High Court's verdict in April, Davina.